नमस्ते एंड ग्रीटिंग्स। आई इशिका चौधरी, रिसर्चर एट इम्प्री, इम्पैक्ट एंड पॉलिसी रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट, प्रभाव एवं नीति अनुसंधान संस्थान, नई दिल्ली, एक्सटेंड माई वार्म वेलकम टू यू ऑल टू इम्प्री हैशटैग वेब पॉलिसी टॉक। टूडे वी हैव गैदर्ड फॉर अ पैनल डिस्कशन ऑन द टॉपिक लेबर मूवमेंट्स इन इंडिया, चैलेंजेस एंड द वे फॉरवर्ड एज अ पार्ट ऑफ द सीरीज द स्टेट ऑफ एम्प्लॉयमेंट एंड लाइवलीहुड्स Hashtag Employment Debate by IMPRI. Moderator for the session is Professor K.R. Shyam Sundar. He is professor at HRM area XI Xavier School of Management, Jamshedpur, and he is also visiting professor at IMPRI. We welcome you, sir. As a special invitee, we have Sayed Sultan. He is work team South Asia, International Labour Organization, IO. We welcome you, sir. As panelists, we have Aseem Roy. He is founding general secretary of New Trade Union Initiative. We welcome you, sir. Dr. Sonia George, she is secretary of Self-Employed Women's Association, Seva Kerala. We welcome you, ma'am. Professor A.V. Joss, he is honorary visiting professor at Center for Development Studies, Kerala. We welcome you, sir. And next we have Sheikh Salahuddin. He is National General Secretary of Indian Federation of App-Based Transport Workers and Founder State President of Telangana Gig and Platform Workers Union. We welcome you, sir. We all look forward to learning from the esteemed gathering. Now I hand over the proceedings to Shyam Sundar, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ishika, for the introductory for introducing the panelists and myself. I'm extremely pleased to be the moderator of this panel discussion organized by IMPRI, Indian Social Institute, New Delhi, and Counterview on the theme Labor Movement in India at 75, Challenges and the Way Forward. Is a part of the series called The State of Employment and Livelihoods, Hashtag Employment Debate, which has been organized by IMPRI, ISI, and Counterview for quite some time. I've had the pleasure of having participated as a panelist, as well as moderating several of the web of these kinds of programs. I'm indeed very happy to act as a moderator of this very important topic. What are the challenges that labor movement at 75 face, and what could be the way forward? So we have a very illustrious set of panelists. Professor A.V. Joss, currently honorary visiting professor at CDS Trivandrum. Formerly, he worked close to three decades in ILO. And we have Mr. Aseem Roy, founding general secretary NTUI, Dr. Sonia George, secretary Seva Kerala, Mr. Sultan, ACTRAV, ILO New Delhi office, and Sheikh Salahuddin, national general secretary of IFAT, and founder president of Telangana Gig and Platform Workers Union. As a moderator, I thought I would flag some issues which I request the panelists to consider taking forward if they found them to be of merit. The first and the foremost challenge that I find, which is contemporaneous, is the existential right of life and livelihood, not only of workers, but of the entire humanity. And workers constitute a good proportion of the humanity. So what could labor unions, workers organizations, civil society organizations could do in order to prevail over the governments, the global organizations, both financial and the United Nations, and various other bodies to secure security, right to life, and right to livelihood, which in a sense are intertwined. What could the trade unions do on a wider scale, in a very broad sweep? That would be, for me, is the immediate existential challenge that the labor movement faces. May also add, when Dr. Arjun asked me about this topic, I said not trade union movement, but labor movement, in the sense that we started with the labor movement and matured into trade union movement. And now, thanks to globalization, we are, in a sense, we need to broaden labor movement, not in the primitive sense, but in a modern sense, so as to be inclusive of all kinds of workers' organizations and human rights-based organizations. So in that sense, I use the term labor movement in that umbrella sense. The second one is quite ideological again. You know, the pandemic has been used by the neoliberal institutions, including the state, to push ahead the neoliberal reform agenda, which is quite evident if we simply flip through the pages of the various government pronouncements made by Government of India since 2020 March. The main things that come to me are the structural reforms: privatization, corporatization, mergers, monetization of public assets, etc. And also pushing the labor codes along with the farmers' bills, which I'll come to that. That brings me to the third one. The farmers' protests, the success of them, have shown the way, probably a way, for the working class movement to try to imitate, notwithstanding the limitations that the working class movement can face. I'm sure the panelists would be alive to the challenges in the process of imitating farmers' protests by the industrial working class. Now, if sustained, persistent, long duration struggle that was waged by farmers proved to be impossible or implausible for the industrial working class, what else can it do? What innovative methods, apart from annual rituals of going on countrywide protests, what else can they do? Of course, IFAT has shown the way, along with legal activists like Ms. Indra Jay Singh, Gayatri Singh, and others, that legal contestation for social security rights, can that be one window that it could look at? And as I speak today, there are two important news items that I saw. One is that the retail inflation, consumer price, CPI-based inflation rate is touching 6%, 5.99 to be precise. And an article in the Indian Express, which came about eight hours ago, argued that unemployment in December 2021 touched 7.91%. So unemployment is stubborn, looking quite stubborn, particularly urban unemployment. Labor force participation in India is lower than the comparable emerging countries. We have inflation, both retail inflation at 6%, it is breaching the comfort zone of RBI. And wholesale inflation has gone beyond 10%, around 12%. So we have this uneasy macroeconomic picture. The budget is on the anvil. And to me, the biggest issue that the labor movement faces is a modern issue, that of identity of people as workers, of people who are participating in the gig economy. We call them as workers. Are they legally workers? The millions of Anganwadi Asha workers, the government calls them as volunteers. Are they workers? So we are facing, on the one hand, we have the conventional sector, which is facing numerous assaults on the historically established labor rights. On the other hand, we are facing modern issues such as the very identity, the vast majority of informal economy, informal workers, people who are working in the informal sector, the modern sector like the gig. I mean, one of the industrial bodies has said that by 2025, there would be around 450 million gig jobs, kinds of gig jobs. I mean, this seems to be a fantastic piece of news to me, but I have not looked into that particular information base. And the trade unions, national trade unions, have waged more than 20 countrywide protests since 1992. The trade unions estimate puts it somewhere between 100 million and 100 million and 250 million. This is a huge mass movement of the kind that the world wouldn't have seen anywhere in the globe. But still, the labor codes have been pushed through, structural reforms have been announced, and Air India is on sale, and LIC IPO is going to come in soon. And today the government has said that it would buy stakes in Vodafone, going to the aid of Vodafone. On the one hand, it is going to the aid of Vodafone. On the other hand, it says it needs to withdraw from the economy. I mean, it's sending clearly neoliberal signals. Now, how do we tackle these challenges? Now, I just have only one recommendation to the labor movement I would like the panelists to consider. Now, the trade union movement has broadened that struggle agenda from the core trade union issues to the broader economic social issues. Like ILO, it had 183 conventions and then the global community asked ILO to pick up core conventions, and it came up with 8 conventions on 4 subjects. I don't need to repeat them. Similarly, can the labor movement look at 3 to 4 core issues and wage a persistent struggle, which would also give them a sense of legitimacy? I just want to list them. For example, identity of all the people who are in the world of work as workers. That is number one. Number two, clear enforcement and entitlement of minimum wages, easily accessible universal social security, and universal occupational and safety and health. You know, yesterday's Indian Express carried a news item wherein a Zomato worker's vehicle was run over by SUV. I mean, the Zomato can say that there is an insurance policy in place, but the way the Zomato, the gig platforms operate, that seems to be pushing these people under unusual kinds of life risks and livelihood risks. And look at these three or four, I have just flagged them as an example. And this will gain, according to me, to the movement, a huge sense of legitimacy. Who would deny these, you know, critical minimum labor rights, identity, minimum wage, social security, right to life and livelihood, and just go on a huge strike, which may probably give it a sense of success. Even the government cannot go on a back foot on these things. So with these preliminary remarks, I now invite Professor A.V. Jose to share his perspective. Thank you very much once again to IMPRI, ISI, and Counterview. Thanks.
Thank you. I guess I am audible, and it's a pleasure, it's a privilege being here to talk on a subject I worked on for many years. When I was with the ILO, I had the privilege of coordinating a major undertaking, which essentially looked into the future of trade unions. And it was titled Organized Labor in the 21st Century. We got a large number of very prominent union leaders all over the world and representatives of the employer community to interact with us on this particular project and share ideas about how they perceive the future. So whatever I say has some relationship with what I learned in that project. And therefore, let me say at the outset, I'm entirely in agreement with the minimal core agenda, which all people concerned about labor should pursue in India. Let's be aware of the fact we are too big a country, too heterogeneous, a mix of cultures to have centralized, unified solutions. And when we say that the state, the central state has failed on such and such fronts, I mean, I think we are essentially talking about impossible things. Ideally, one should focus on a minimum, a bare minimum. That's very much in conformity with the traditional mandate of the trade unions. They were institutions of the industrial society, which came to the fore to answer the social question of Europe that surfaced in the 18th and 19th centuries in the course of industrialization. Factors, the circumstances that led to endemic poverty, profound deprivation, unequal relations at work, and misery, malnutrition, and all those compounded together, which defined the social problem of industrializing Europe. And the unions came forward with solutions to that. They worked with workers, trudged a long, lengthy, laborious way, witnessed the entire transformative process, campaigned for a new political reality wherein the rights and entitlements of workers were given paramount importance and framed within the framework, constitutionalized within the framework of social democratic societies. They evolved rules and regulations binding on workers, mainly of the industrialized world, authored a legal architecture which was meant to be emulated in the rest of the world. But then it was a long, laborious journey, wading through the sweat and blood of workers all over the world. In the process, taking them literally, to use a biblical expression, the very promised land. And the unions played an extremely important role in attaining that and created the institutional safeguards of reasonably affluent societies, which safeguarded the interests of workers, for which they built on the material prosperity of industrialization and created the economic space from which they created the political space for participation of workers in creating new institutions and safeguards, with the net result, the industrial society came to imbibe a number of minimum requirements, minimum wages, solidarity wages, minimum wages that ensured floor level was maintained, solidarity wages which ensured that the inequalities did never come up, social security benefits that ensured secure living to workers. In the process, what they ensured was the stability of industrial economies and facilitated the creation of institutions for emulation in the world of work everywhere. And the ILO was a crucial stage wherein that emulation, that adaptation was fostered. Building up of the organizing strength and mobilizing capacity, which gave the workers the capacity to influence decisions in the industrial society, was a remarkable achievement of the unions. And that golden age between the second quarter of the 20th century to the end of the third quarter, I mean, you know, just over about 50 years, that was the golden age wherein these institutions flourished. And they were in a position to say that these are good enough to be adopted in the rest of the world. But then came globalization and dented the whole process. Threw a spanner into the works and created deep anguish and suspicion about the feasibility of institutions to safeguard the interests of workers. And whatever we saw and what followed was something that made us all despondent about the future of the working class. We realized that the world, the emerging world of work, was one where the institutional safeguards were not going to be kept alive. And therefore, the challenge before the unions, I would imagine, is to go back to the scratch, start from square one, focus on the very same tasks. They provided answers to the social questions of the industry, the industrializing societies, and start with them. Focus on those workers at the lower end of the workforce, people who just don't belong to the organized sector anymore, people who are deprived of the benefits of formal relations at the workplace, and they are swelling in large numbers. The outgrowth of contract workers, the gig workers, people outside the protective umbrella of the state. I think it's time we refocused attention on them all over India. Make them part of a political process wherein their minimal interests would be protected by all the parties concerned, the central and the state governments together, because it's an extremely important political constituency of beneficiaries. The extent to which minimum wages can be accorded to them, minimum social safety regulations can be extended to them, social safety regulations involving retirement pensions that ensure them a living through and beyond the working lives, healthcare, housing, all these requirements can be met through the diversion of resources of the state. We always come across questions, where is the money for that? The fact of the matter is the society we belong to harbor such deep inequalities and has the wherewithal to meet these requirements, to take care of the interests, the economic interests of the poor. Therefore, let's come back to the very old process where the economic interests, the economic space we accord to them, build into a political space, and they effectively become partners in the shaping of institutions that take care of a social floor, a floor below which the market forces will not ever drive them down on the wages front, on the habitat front, on the comforts front, on the pensions question, on the healthcare front. All these together have got to be guaranteed by the state with allocation of resources which are well within the reach of a developing society like ours. And there's no point in pretending that we don't have the money to do that. It's a question of a political will being there. And that's why I think it's a political process that we have got to be engaged in. And therefore, the beneficiaries will certainly be part of that political process, which in turn will come to the kind of a business model which makes the unions self-financing entities with a prominent place in the administration and management of the very same institutions, wage enforcement, income security, social security, all these are to be administered with the participation of unions, like it's being done in the Scandinavian countries. And therefore, the collapse of the membership, which people see all over the world, the organizing strength and mobilizing capacity of unions is not much of a problem so long as they have the kind of a preeminent position in managing the institutions that safeguard the interests of workers. And I think that's what we have got to work at. When you talk about challenges before the unions in the coming decades, this is where I think one has got to focus on, protect the interests of the most weak and vulnerable in the labor markets, whose ranks are swelling, whose numbers are exploding. But then there is a ray of hope in the future, in the sense the demography has peaked, the demographic explosion has peaked, and we are certainly going to reap what is called the demographic dividend of increased participation of men and women in the labor force. And therefore, what has got to be ensured is the very minimum, the floor that has got to be built up. And that is an eminently feasible task for the epistemic community, the scholars who want to work on it, and the activists down below, and the large, large array of concerned social activists. And I'm sure Sonia, who would come in later, will talk about the kind of work she's doing among women, especially in the domestic work sector, and where we have got to make sure that the interests of these people are protected through legislative action of the central and state governments. And that's where I think the campaign has to start, and it has got to be part of a completely political mobilization process. And I would think this as the kind of an idea, the challenge for trade unions, before trade unions in the years to come. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose, for both the historical perspective and asking the trade union movement to draw lessons from the history, and also, arguing very persuasively that unless the trade unions drew lessons from history, the so-called social question that raged in the 18th and 19th century, which resulted in the kind of labor rights, minimum wage to collective bargaining rights to state assured social security. So that heralded a kind of a widened labor, widened and deep rooted labor movement. And that is what that could be a solution if the trade unions and various other organizations would go back to the marginalized, vulnerable, on the margin and beyond the margin workers, organize them, mobilize them, and you know, probably you know, impart a sense of political you know, a political organizational aspect to it. And then one could ask for a non-negotiable social floor, which the market cannot attack on. And of course, you also, like an economist, very clearly argued that the fiscal conservative arguments that there are not enough resources to provide the social minimum, social floor. And you argued that if there are tremendous inequalities that are prevalent in the economy, that inequalities, I mean, solving the inequalities could be a source of financing the social minimum floor is a very important argument that the labor movement needs to catch on and tell the society and the government, look, you solve inequality, and that will finance the social minimum floor that the labor movement is asking for. So there are three challenges that Professor Jose has put before the trade union movement or the larger labor movement. Look at the vast majority of vulnerable workers, informal workers. Number two, create a framework for agitation. And thirdly, look for political solutions. And these are valuable lessons, valuable suggestions, recommendations coming from one who has worked for a long time, both as an economist and also as an ILO official, highly placed ILO official. I'm sure they would be considered by the labor movement with all the merit that they deserve. With these remarks, may now request Mr. Sheikh Salahuddin to share his thoughts on the challenges that the gig economy workers are facing. Over to you, Mr. Sheikh.
Thank you so much, sir, giving this opportunity. Thank you, each and everyone. We can speak Hindi, sir?
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
बात कर सकते
हैं. जी. अगर जब सर तो प्रोफेसर सर बहुत खुले अंदाज में कहे थे आज जो आज के तारीख में हमें ट्रेड यूनियनिस्ट भी करना चाहिए, करना होगा और आगे हमारे सामने है सो चैलेंजेस. तो मैं इसको लेके ज्यादा नहीं करना चाह रहा हूँ कि जैसे कि आप भी स्टार्टिंग में इंट्रोडक्शन पे बोले थे कि इंडियन फेडरेशन ऑफ ऐप बेस्ड ट्रांसपोर्ट वर्कर्स आज एक पहला एक चुनौती इस कंपनी के सामने पूरी रखने की कोशिश की. हमारे ड्राइवर्स हो चाहे डिलीवरी वर्कर्स हो, जितने भी गिग वर्कर्स और प्लेटफॉर्म वर्कर्स पे काम करने वाले हैं, इन लोग को लेके हम लोग ने इंदिरा जयसिंह जैसे बड़े दिग्गज लायर्स, फ्रेंडली लायर्स जो लेबर के ऊपर काम कर रहे हैं, उनको लेके हम लोग ने सुप्रीम कोर्ट के सामने दरवाजा खटखटाया, PIL डाल के. अब हमारा एक हमारे सामने ये है कि कहाँ तक हम लोग इसके अंदर सक्सेस लेंगे, कंपनीज को कहाँ तक घुटनों पे टेक के हमारे सक्सेसेस को हम हासिल करेंगे, ये सारी चीज अभी अगले आने वाले दिनों में होने वाली है. मगर एक चीज मैं यहाँ पे बार बार दोहरा रहा हूँ कि आज के तारीख में जो कंपनीज है, चाहे वो स्विगी हो, जोमैटो हो, अमेजोन हो, फ्लिपकर हो, डेंजो हो, शैडोफैक्स हो, जो छोटी कंपनी बड़े 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 स्थाई पे जा रही है आज, वो सारे कंपनीज जो है बीते हुए अगर जब हम 8 साल से बात करें तो कंटिन्यूसली हमारा शोषण करते जा रहे. वजह क्या है बोले तो यहाँ पे इसके ऊपर पॉलिसी मेकिंग नहीं हुई, इसके ऊपर कोई कानून नहीं बना, चाहे वो ट्रांसपोर्ट सेक्टर से हो, चाहे वो लेबर सेक्टर से हो, चाहे वो आईटी सेक्टर से हो. 2021 में तो पार्लियामेंट में पास किया, बट इम्प्लीमेंटेशन अभी तक 1.5 साल होने आया, अभी तक उसका इम्प्लीमेंटेशन नहीं हुआ. इतना ही नहीं, अगर जब हम डिलीवरी बॉयज के जैसे स्टार्टिंग में आप कहे थे, जैसे कि हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस को लेके, उनके हेल्थ एंड सेफ्टी को लेके जो बात कह रहे थे, तो कहीं पे भी ये इस कंपनीज ने पूरी तरह से हमारे जो राइट्स है, हमारे को जो मिलना था वो सारे चीज से दूर कर दिए। बिकॉज द रीजन आप देख सकते हैं, इन लोग ने पार्टनर बोल के सारे हमारे जो हक थे वो हक से दूर कर दिया। जैसे कि डिलीवरी पार्टनर बोल दिए, जैसे कि ओला उबर पार्टनर बोल दिए, पार्टनर का एक दर्जा दे दे के जो है हमारे जो बेनिफिट्स है वो सारे बेनिफिट्स को इन लोग कंपनी ने तोड़ दिया। और जैसे कि अब हम बात बता रहे कि जो कंपनीज ने कह रहे कि हम लोग 6 लाख इंश्योरेंस देंगे, 5 लाख इंश्योरेंस देंगे, आज भी आपके आर्टिकल में बात निकल के आई कि मेरे पास ऐसे लोग जो डिलीवरी बॉयज है जो आप 10 मिनट का समय लगा रहे, 15 मिनट का समय लगा रहे उनके ऊपर डिलीवरी, आप फास्ट डिलीवरी देंगे बोल के, कितना इम्पैक्ट गिर रहा हमारे वो डिलीवरी बॉय पे कि वो 10 मिनट में रॉन्ग रूट जाना पड़ रहा है, एक्सीडेंट फेस करना पड़ रहा, उस एक्सीडेंट्स में माजूर हो जा रहा, माने डिजेबल हो जा रहा, पैर हार टूट के कोई जान से चले जा रहा, क्यों इतना 10 मिनट का ऑफर लगाने में क्या, 10 मिनट शॉर्ट डिलीवरी देने में क्या हासिल करना चाह रही कंपनी। माने यहाँ पे ड्राइवर्स डिलीवरी बॉयज का जान जोखिम में डाल के और उसको प्रेशराइज करके क्या हासिल करना चाह रहे, ये जो शोषण करना चाह रहे ना, इसके ऊपर हमें आज के तारीख में भी अगले आने वाले दिनों में इस चीज के ऊपर बातचीत पे चर्चा पे जरूर लाना पड़ेगा। ये जो कंपनीज है इतने प्रेशर में लाके वर्कर्स को जो डाल के प्रेशराइज कर रहे टाइम बॉन्ड के अंदर, वो हमें सोचना होगा। इतना ही नहीं, ये जो भी ई कॉमर्स के ऊपर हम लोग काम कर रहे हैं, ये पूरा जो है रेटिंग के सिस्टम पे डिपेंड होके जा रहा, ये रेटिंग सिस्टम से भी बहुत सारे हमारे जो हक है, जैसे कि सोचो कि कस्टमर से कंज्यूमर से बहुत सारी बार हमारे को यही डराव निकाला था कि आप अगर जल्दी नहीं लाएंगे तो हम आपकी रेटिंग कम कर देंगे, ठीक है ना। अगर जब आप आते आते कोई दूसरा काम बोल देते कहीं आप सिगरेट लाना होगा एडिशनली, ओके आप आते टाइम थोड़ा सब्जी ले लेके आना, नहीं तो आते टाइम ये चीज पकड़ के लाना, ये उसके अंदर रहता ही नहीं, ये एक्सेसिबल नहीं है। फिर भी जो है डिलीवरी बॉय अपने रेटिंग के लिए कहीं ना कहीं मजबूर होना पड़ रहा, और वो लोकेशन कहीं और लगाता और कहीं बुलाता डिलीवरी लेने के लिए, ठीक है ना। और कैब की अगर जब हम बात करें टैक्सी के सेक्टर में, ओला उबर में, कोई गाड़ी बुक और करते, कोई गाड़ी पे चढ़ के जाते कोई और है, तो ये सारे जो है लीगल टर्म्स एंड पॉलिसीज के अंदर उनके आईडीज ब्लॉक करना छोटे छोटे कारण पे, उनको रोजगार से बेरोजगार कर देना, ऐसे मुद्दे बहुत सारे आज के तारीख में पीक इश्यूज है। देखिए, रोजगार को बेरोजगार करना कंपनी के लिए बहुत आसान है, बेरोजगार को रोजगार करते बोल के ये सारे जो कंपनीज थे गिग इकोनॉमी काम कर रहे वो सारे लोग ने कहा था, मगर आज आप देख सकते बहुत सारे लोग को यही कंपनी वाले ने रोजगार को बेरोजगार बना रहे आईडीज ब्लॉक करके। तो ये सारे जो मुद्दे है कहीं ना कहीं हमारे लेबर रिलेटेड है, लेबर से जुड़ते हुए है, इनके ऊपर कानून बनना चाहिए, कानून किस एंगल में बनना, कैसा कानून बनना, कानून किस तरीके से मैं कंट्रोल रखना, इसके ऊपर कैसा फ्रेमवर्क होना चाहिए, ये कंपनीज का रोल क्या है, गवर्नमेंट का रोल क्या है, लेबर डिपार्टमेंट का रोल क्या है, आईटी का रोल क्या है, ट्रांसपोर्ट का रोल क्या है, ये सारे चीज हमें एक बैठ के एक अम्ब्रेला पे काम करना जरूरी है, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया हो चाहे स्टेट गवर्नमेंट हो। अगर जब हम बात करें तो ये सारे कंपनीज जो है आज तक जैसे कि पार्लियामेंट में कहा कि हम लोग इनका नेशनल सोशल सिक्योरिटी के अंदर बोर्ड बनाएंगे, वहां पे 2% सेस से जो है इन लोग का डेवलपमेंट के ऊपर खर्चा करेंगे और इनके वेलफेयर पे खर्चा करेंगे। कंपनी हर राइट पे सर, हर राइट पे, हर डिलीवरी पे 20 से 25%, 25 से 30% ले रही इंक्लूडिंग जीएसटी के साथ। अब तो क्या कंपनी से आप एनुअल टर्नओवर पे 2% 1% सेस मांग रहे, क्या ये है? आप कंपनी को बढ़ा के सेस लेके और डेवलपमेंट का जो अमाउंट है वो हमारे डेवलपमेंट पे लगाइए ना, हमारे वेलफेयर पे लगाइए ना। हर स्टेट के अंदर स्टेट का वेलफेयर बोर्ड भी बनना चाहिए, चाहे वो पूरा गिग वर्कर्स का, वो क्या बनाएंगे, कैसा बनाएंगे, उसका स्ट्रक्चर क्या होगा, पता नहीं अभी तक किसी को भी। गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया सामने आना होगा, इसका काम जल्द से जल्द करना होगा। पैंडेमिक से पैंडेमिक के बाद पार्लियामेंट में जितने भी बिल पास हुए वो सारे बिल पार्लियामेंट के बाहर इम्प्लीमेंटेशन होना भी स्टार्ट किया, बट यहाँ पे सोशल सिक्योरिटी कोड का जो पार्लियामेंट में बिल पास हुआ उसका ड्राफ्ट बनने के लिए चले गया 1.5 साल तक, अभी तक वो ड्राफ्ट बना ही नहीं। क्या है ये? इसके बाद वाले जितने भी ड्राफ्ट बन गए निकल गए, इम्प्लीमेंटेशन भी हो रहे, तो गवर्नमेंट को इंटरेस्ट नहीं है या कंपनी की प्राइवेटाइज्ड सिस्टम जो आप बताए थे प्राइवेट सिस्टम के ऊपर पूरा आना चाहिए क्या? प्राइवेट के जो कंपनीज है एग्रीगेटर कंपनीज उनके हाथ में कंट्रोल देके उन्होंने जो पॉलिसी बनाएंगे वो पॉलिसी अब गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया इंप्लीमेंट करेंगी क्या? ये अभी भी अधूरा सवाल का जवाब है गवर्नमेंट के पास हमारे पास। तो इसके ऊपर जब भी पॉलिसी बन रही पूरी पॉलिसी बन के बाहर आएंगी आप जैसे लोग हम जैसे लोग इसके अंदर इन्वॉल्व होना आवाज उठाना और इनके जो भी लूप पॉइंट्स है ऑलरेडी इंडियन फेडरेशन ऑफ एप बेस्ड ट्रांसपोर्ट वर्कर्स आईफेट के तरफ से आप सबकी सहमति से हम लोग ड्राफ्ट भी दे चुके हैं केंद्र सरकार को क्या हमें होना है गिग वर्कर्स को। अभी तक उसका भी जवाब सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट से नहीं आया तो अभी वेट एंड सी करना है देखना है कि अगले आने वाले दिनों में इसका क्या नतीजा हल निकल के बाहर आएगा। बस आप सबसे भी ये पूरी उम्मीद है हमारी ब्लेस करिए दुआ करिए अगले आने वाले दिनों में जो सुप्रीम कोर्ट में हमारा जो पीएल डाल के है हमारे हक वहां से मिलके हम लोग जरूर हमें तो पूरी उम्मीद है सुप्रीम कोर्ट के चीफ जस्टिस पे कहीं ना कहीं हमें इंसाफ होगा इस कंपनीज के अगेंस्ट में। थैंक यू सो मच।
थैंक यू शेख जी। मैं अंग्रेजी में बोलूंगा क्योंकि मेरा हिंदी इतना ठीक नहीं है। शेख जी हैज यू नो लेड बेयर द काइंड ऑफ ट्रैप दैट द गिग economy workers have been put into. On the one hand, they have the platform capitalists who are pushing them through. I mean, it's a kind of a, you know, I mean, one is reminded of the assembly line kind of pressure that we saw in pictures like Modern Times of Charlie Chaplin. I mean, you increase the speed of the assembly line process, and then the workers will have to increase their mechanical activity. So that kind of a thing that one is observing with regard to the labor processes that are at work in the gig economy. Push, deliver fast, do it, because the consumers are waiting. I mean, is there a false sense of alarm that these platform capitalists are creating? A kind of a pressure. And the second one is that this incentive is a big trap. They give incentives, pull them into the whirlpool, get them indebted, and change the incentive structure in a manner that is disadvantageous to this gig economy workers. So they are, on the one hand, they are caught up with huge loan amounts. On the other hand, they have to deliver the kind of the workload that is huge workload that this platform capitalism imposes. So they are caught in this trap. On the other hand, there are impatient customers who are brandishing their weapons of rating systems to demand, as he said, give us additional services lest you shall be rated badly. So this gig economy workers are caught up between two agents of capitalism. On the one hand, the capitalists who have founded these platforms. On the other hand, the consumers who are the financiers of this kind of consumer capitalism. So what should they do? So the government has not come forward with anything credible, notwithstanding the fact that these gig economy workers unions, which are coming up fast, have provided. So that is the third trap that they are. They need to go to the state, meaning the government, as well as knock at the doors of judiciary. We hope, Sheikh Bhai, that the Supreme Court will deliver some position, some judgment which is favorable, which would prove some solace to the sufferings of millions of gig workers. And as if the predictions of the industry are true, the gig economy will be the huge workforce, in the future to come. So he has asked for blessings, and we shall give him ideas, and we shall give these gig economy unions intellectual strength, public support. And at the same time, I request the gig economy platform unions to mobilize consumer opinion, to work with consumers, public welfare bodies, consumer organizations, so that NGOs and others, so that together they could mount a kind of a credible opposition to this platform capitalism. Thank you very much, Sheikh Bhai, for giving this perspective. Now, I see that Dr. Sonia George has joined us. Dr. Sonia, are you able to? Are you there? Dr. Sonia? Okay. In the meanwhile, we have Mr. Sultan Ahmed, who is ACTRA representative at the New Delhi office of ILO, South Asian office of ILO. May I request Mr. Sultan Ahmed to share his views on the theme of today's panel discussion.
Thank you very much, Professor Shamsundar. It is a privilege for me actually to talk with you and Professor A.B. Josh and some other colleagues, those who have vast field experience like Sheikh Salahuddin and everything. Thanks IMPRI to invite me and this initiative has given me the opportunity to listen Professor Josh, and I have regular interaction with Professor Shamsundar, so I know that his thought and everything. I am not here actually to make any recommendation for the trade union, because Indian trade union, as you mentioned, that it is 75 years of the independence, but Indian trade union has 100 years of history. Last year, actually 2019 was the 100 years of the Indian trade union, undivided Indian trade union movement. And they have still the much mature leadership, capable leadership. They have the history, what Professor Abhi just mentioned. I don't want to mention this, repeat it again. I want to speak some word from three of you that very rightly Professor Shamsundar mentioned some folk areas, especially the identity crisis. This whole thing actually, the present status, strength of the trade union movement and recognition of the trade union movement actually now lies with this thing. Because day by day, because of the informalization, expansion, platform and everything, day by day actually union losing, the workers are losing their identity. They are no more workers. There are confusion many. And not only the gig economy workers, I'm telling you, there are huge number of educated youth, junior professional workers. Those are also like ASHA workers, they say volunteer, gig workers, they are saying that they are the part of the corporate house or they are not the employee. Then what about these IT young youth professional groups, those who are very junior engineer, junior doctors, bankers and everything, and then others, government service order. There are many, many areas. That means day by day with very planned strategy, we are squeezing the actually area of workers, the world of work. We are saying many, we are using many different terminology for that. And then we have essential service, we have security service, many things, you know, that trade union, they cannot join trade union, some cannot go for a strike like this. So this is one issue which actually we, the trade union movement, labor movement as a whole, need to take as a number one agenda. That how we can bring all the working people under the labor law coverage, entitlement that they can organize and bargain collectively, and they represent themselves. They can raise their voice. They can identify themselves that we are workers. And we build this country. We are the part of this development. We have the rights which we accept, as what Professor Abhi Joshi just mentioned, that it is we accept by our sacrifice, blood, and long struggle. We are entitled for this. If you see now, I am in Bangladesh now. I am connecting from Dhaka actually. And I have seen some young doctors, engineers, and IT professionals. Those are very young, and they joined in hospitals, private hospitals, bank, and everywhere. You know, their average working hour is 12 hours. And that is declared. That it's not that they're saying that, okay, you are 8 hours and 4 hours like this, this. They don't have any wage structure. Yeah. Same time, same thing. Last month, two months back, I was in Hyderabad, where Sheikh Salahuddin was also there. The driver who actually I hired from the airport to drop me in the seminar area, seminar venue, and I tried to understand from him that what is the status of this thing. He said that their duty is 24 hours. And he has no grievance for that. He thought that is the system. So the surrender habituated with the system, which is totally inhuman, which is totally against the our rights, recognized rights, who our previous generation achieved. That is a very dangerous thing, you know, that we think that this is normal. This is, we need to accept it. So this is one thing. Second, what Professor Josh mentioned, that focus. If you allow me, my observation, I know there's a very experienced person is here, but my observation last at least one decade, there are a clear strategy, planned strategy to shift trade union movement focus from their original focus to others. There are many terminology we have. Nowadays, we are not using collective bargaining. We are using social dialogue. I have no problem to use social dialogue. But when you say social dialogue and we limit our definition, don't clear the social dialogue definition that what actually social dialogue, how it's lead to support the collective bargaining. We feel that arranging some seminar, arranging some discussion, arranging some meeting is enough for these things. So this is one area how we can shift the things. How we can shift trade union labor movement focus from what Professor just mentioned, the political mobilization, to some home-based meeting, regular discuss, soft discussion, I guess. The mobilization word, we are not using this nowadays, sometime. I'm not saying that it's only ILO, it's only trade union movement, it's only international global trade union, not that. As a whole, it's like this. No, we are now the focus on development, CSR, like this thing. So there are many areas where actually the tendency to shift the labor movement focus from their conventional, classical, right-based, mobilization-based activities to different area, different aspect, different issues. So this is another word I think we need to consider, that how we can bring back ourselves, those who are the part of the labor movement. Even ACTRAB, I consider always the part of the labor. I don't know, maybe Professor Josh can correct me if I'm wrong, but I always, and I am from the labor movement actually. So the identity, we need to bring all the working people in the world of work, that they are worker, they are entitled to be organized, they are entitled to talk, they are entitled to raise their voice, and they are entitled to have all the rights which achieved by the labor movement throughout the history. Second, we need to focus our basic fundamental rights. And when the world is debating whether the occupational health and safety is fundamental rights or not, we can easily imagine what is the crisis. We need not to say many things on these things. After all the disaster and everything, still after 100 years of ILO and more than 100 years of the trade union movement, we are still hearing that in global area, global states, people are debating whether occupational health and safety can be considered as fundamental rights or not. So we need to go long, and we need to go actually further to go together beyond all the discussion, all the terminology we are using nowadays. And I can say just two things, that actually to need to re-strategize all the activities, strategy and everything, that how we can reach these vast workers, those who are not feel that they are workers, those who are not recognized as workers, like agriculture workers, like platform workers and every other workers. We need to identify their status. Without this, and still that is lacking, I can say. I can tell you. Still, we think that with our present strength, we can continue with this, our movement and everything. We can't. But that does not mean that we shift from formal to informal. Because formal is our stronghold. We need to build our capacity there. We need to strengthen our will. We need to be stronger there also in formal sector. But we need to reach to vast majority of the workers, those who are not organized. So this is a strategy one. Second is we need to strategy that how we can build our capacity to deal with this, all this new technology, new development paradigm, development agenda and everything. Now, we are dealing with the labor ministry, but many issues like, many issues come, what I mentioned about that, the shifting from workers' rights, that now there are mass discussion about corporate social responsibility, about this even, covenant and other things. Social and the guiding principle for the business and human rights. And those are actually dealing by another ministry, other UN agencies. So trade union movement has a dilemma that actually there are labor issue, but deal by other ministries, other UN agencies and others. So we need to actually equip ourselves with different tools so that we can deal with those issues also with different stakeholders. We can bring all the actors together to do the things. And last I would say that, these another shifting I feel that solidarity and volunteerism. If you see, if you go back 10 years back or 20 years back, if there is any problem, if there is any violation in jute industry or bank industry, if there are any movement in bank industry, there will be solidarity action from textile industry. If there is any violation, any movement, any non-movement in mine industry, any accident in mine industry, there will be solidarity action from bank industry. This is no more in South Asia. I don't know in other countries, but South Asia, solidarity is a word, is one of the main factors of trade unionism and main factors of trade union strength is almost gone. So this is one area we need to bring all together. So one, we need to stand for each other. And another one is volunteerism. Because it's becoming like this, that each and everything is on payment. And if you want to mobilize the people, you need to expend a lot of money to these things. That trade union movement cannot do it. So these all the things actually we need to consider for a way forward. And if you, as Sonia is here, so from ACTRAB, we actually trying our best in last 2-3 years. We support trade union to set up workers information and support center after this COVID to reach to the vulnerable workers, those who are not organized, those who are not unionized in Chennai, in Mumbai, in Delhi, and in Bihar. It has started and we will expanding these things. We actually in last December, we have a South Asian exclusive training for the occupational health and safety volunteers. We actually tell them that you are the volunteers to do the, to advancing your advocacy, to promote the trade union movement, to advancing the issue of the labor workers. And where we invited person like Sheikh Salahuddin, we invited our women activists, those are not yet to be organized. So we invited domestic workers from around the South Asia. So these are the things I think the world we can focus, we can think to re-strategize ourselves, how to go ahead, go forward. Thank you very much. Thank you. And thanks again to give me the opportunity to listen here from. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sultan, for this fine encapsulation of this major issues. And you have, in fact, set out the agenda, in a sense. I mean, taking on from what I said and what Professor Joe said, you made a very fundamental plea. You gave a fundamental argument which should provide a tremendous amount of energy and legitimacy to the labor movement. It is the labor which contributes to the economic process through sweat and blood, the phrase used by Professor Jose. If this could be recognized, then on this very important socio-economic political premise, the entire re-strategizing that you talked about could be built. You also spoke about a planned shift in the focus. Of course, as academics, we were wondering when ILO disbanded the term collective bargaining and brought in social dialogue, removed industrial relations and brought in social dialogue. We as academics were wondering what the ILO was doing. Social dialogue and collective bargaining cannot be one and the same. Collective bargaining has inherent in its system, philosophy and perspective, the right to strike, whereas social dialogue, as Saros Kuribilla and others have argued, and of course, Professor Jose also, has its conservative limits. So you just indicated in a very subtle manner the kind of shift that are taking place. Again, you also emphasized, following Professor Jose, that we need to go back to the rights-based narrative. And it's extremely, I agree with you that it becomes, when the core ILO conventions were announced sometime in the late 1990s, when I didn't find occupational safety and health as a part of core convention, it really led me wondering as to, what is ILO talking about? It is a life, the safety, the right to earn wages would depend on the right to occupational safety and health. And that is not recognized as the fundamental human right or core convention. And then, of course, as an economist, I realized that it would have economic implications. So anyway, I reconciled in my manner, but thanks for thanks to ITUC and thanks to COVID, OSH is now resurfacing in the global dialogues to gain the legitimacy to be called, to be packaged as one of the fundamental rights, along with the freedom of association, collective bargaining, forced labor, bonded labor, child labor, and equity, gender equity. Thanks for flagging that issue. But the one thing that you said, holds very important is that the trade unions, when they deal with the state, they do not deal only with the Ministry of Labor and Employment. NAREGA, if you want to ask for right to livelihood in the rural areas, we need to go to the Ministry of Rural Development. We need to talk about women's rights. We need to go to the Ministry of Women and Child and Development. So we need, labor administration by its very nature is multidimensional or multi-ministerial. So in that sense, the trade unions, probably need to have some kind of a training by ACTRA as to dealing with multiple ministries. That is something that I always felt that the trade unions need to be equipped with. And of course, you talked about capacity building. That could be one of the capacity building exercises, Mr. Sultan, that trade unions need to understand and devise strategies. Dealing with ministry, you are on a familiar path. But dealing with the Ministry of Rural Development or Social Welfare or Tribal Welfare and others, we are on a different surface. And overall, you talked about re-strategizing and claiming back the lost spaces and all other things. We are thankful to you. And of course, ILO ACTRA, I'm familiar with the kind of interventions that you and your unit has been making. And Sonia, of course, is here. Dr. Sonia Jaj is, of course, here. She would be able to throw much light on that. Thank you, Mr. Sultan, for really flagging the issues which are traditionally swept under the carpet, which are not convenient issues to talk about, and you brought them to the on the social platform. to say it so. And now may request Dr. Sonia Judge to outline the challenges that as she who has been trained, she's a leader in organizing informal workers for a long time, the challenges faced by the informal economy. Over to you, Dr. Sonia Judge.
Thank you, Professor Shyam. IMPRI and other organizers for organizing such a contextual discussion. I'm sorry I could join only late, but I was hearing it through Facebook, the Facebook Live I was hearing from the beginning. I think Professor Shyam and Professor Jose and the respective Salauddin and Mr. Sultan, all of them have explained different aspects of the topic. So maybe I may narrow down to my own experiences and my own understandings on this particular topic, you know, paper movement in its 75 years and the challenges that we have to see. Maybe I would like to start from Professor Jose has said no. He beautifully explained the history of the trade union movements, the labor movements in the world, and also maybe at that juncture in the trade union history in India. So maybe as a person representing the informal economy, I'm curious, or I'm happy, or I'm interested to trace that trade union history or labor movement history from the organized to the unorganized, from the formal to the informal. No, when you look at SEWA, means the organization that I represent, for the last 21 years I work with, SEWA is celebrating its 50th anniversary this year, 2022. So this is the 50th year. So when you go back to the history of SEWA, and where it has started from, the Textile Labor Association initiated by Anasuya Ben in the early 90s, and from there how SEWA has started, the significance of SEWA, such a movement to organize workers who have lost their livelihood, who have lost their jobs in the formal sector. So maybe I think we should start with that context where Professor Jose has explained, after globalization, what had happened, or after the new economic policies and liberalization, and the neoliberalization policies that have been accepted all over the world, what shift had happened in the context of labor, that is important for us to understand. So maybe the present history or the present discussion, present context of the labor movement is post 90s, post globalization or post liberalization. How have the labor in the world, the labor in a country like in a South Asian country like India, that we could understand. So my first argument or a hypothesis is that I think the existing narratives and the existing normatives when we try to understand or explain labor completely is a formal framework. We talk about formal relationships, we talk about formal rights, we talk about Sultan Bhai has mentioned a very, very visible shift. How could we suddenly jump from collective bargaining to social dialogue? That was one. I think that was a very important discussion that we have to come back and discuss again. So how do we understand the existing normative framework where ILO had celebrated its 100th year in 2019, and then we were talking about a very strong tripartite system, That is where the base of negotiations that we are thinking about. So in that tripartite negotiations, that tripartite negotiations that have developed in, during the course of time, the organized labor had found a proper place in terms of collective bargaining, in terms of rights, in terms of organizing, and also in terms of finding proper social security for the sectors. No, it could be public sector, it could be private sector, wherever it is, means that the role of the employer, the role of the state, and the role of the workers with respect to these two actors were well established in all those negotiations and in all the 190 conventions that we are talking about all around the world, means of ILO, that had happened during these 100 years. So my first thought, or my first maybe a kind of reversal that I have to put before you is, how could we challenge this existing normative framework of organized labor relationships? Is there any way to address? Because, for a country like India, where majority of the workers, we say that, are in the informal economy, and we say that informal economy is growing in particular context. The entire labor forces, if you say apart from the 6 or 5%, it's informal. But what are the mechanisms that are available in this process of addressing the informality, informal nature of the workforce? This informality is the process that had, that have increased, during this globalization or new capital advancement that we were talking about, and how the capital have been, totally swallowing labor in the process of making its own roots in the developing country. So now we say, the labor is global south. That is what we try to attempt to say. You talk about migrant workers. Where are this majority of migrant workers coming from? They are from global south, definitely. But any of the present existing structures in the world or in the country, especially a country like India, is there any structure to raise the issues of migrant workers in terms of labor negotiations or in terms of social security or whatever we say? Very simple question. Any of the labor unions in the country, do they have migrant workers as members? That's a very simple question that we have to ask to understand the complexity of this new forces that are coming in. Next is when you talk about supply chains. When you understand, the ongoing struggles of the supply chain workers who are the least, their workers of the supply chain. They are, somebody sitting in somewhere, leading a multinational company, owning a multinational company, and the poor working sitting in, a very remote village in India or Bangladesh or Sri Lanka, working for them, working for their, either garments or whatever that they would like to work as a piece rate worker. What is the relationship between that particular company on the top and the lowest tier of workers? So this is another complex chain, that had been developed post globalization. Means, the production cost, it has to be cheaper. That means, the industry has to be scattered. The entire class, industrial class, male class, society of labor, it has completely dispersed. Post liberalization period. That means we have to talk about, different forms of workplaces which are unstable. Means there are no stable workplaces. There are no permanent workplaces. The work has become temporary. The workplaces kept on shifting. It is going from cheaper to cheaper places. Where the labor is available and where the least production cost is possible. So we have been looking and seeing that shift that is happening. And the next, in that context, we were seeing an increasing number of labor class which is coming up, which is rising in the labor force, in the workforce, where there are no employers. Employers are completely absent. So there again we have to relate to this existing tripartite system where we negotiate with employers, where we negotiate with state, and we talk about a large number of workforce who means ever in their life had any employer to deal with. Means for example, we may call them as self-employed, we may call them as at different levels contract workers, or we may call them as home-based workers or domestic workers, or any categories that we could place them in that categories of developing. And the third one is that means invisible employers or absenteeism of employers, means employees are not present in that labor relationship. And the third, state. Where is state coming in this process? We have seen this, the post liberalized, economic and political phenomena, where the state is withdrawing from the responsibilities, step by step in terms of labor rights or in terms of social security of the citizens or any kind of, Professor Jose was talking about how do we enable a minimum social floor and going back. My argument is that I think we need a new platform to discuss this scenario of informality, the scenario of the existing worker situations. For example, again, I say, the gender disparity that we have to address in the context. For a country like India, continuously for the last around more than 10 years, the participation of women in the employment, in the labor force is continuously deteriorating. It's coming down. Is it true? The kind of framework that we have established, to take out the data, or to represent women in the workforce, is it enabling the participation or is it enabling the visibilization of women in the workforce that we have to start understanding? Because home has become a workplace and home is not a workplace in any of the industrial relations, in any of the industrial relations, establishment, rule or law in the country. So that means increasingly home is becoming workplace and more women who are working in the home, they are completely displaced or disappeared in this kind of enumerative process that is happening as part of labor force participation survey or NSSO surveys or whatever survey that is taking place in the process. So the new forms of, one thing we have understood clearly that, the capacity we have talked about, we talk about recommendation 204 where, there should be, a transition towards formalization of the informal workers. But I think in a country like India, those processes are very complex, with the context of increasing in informality. And we have seen, last 2 years how COVID has displaced, majority of people, especially women workers from the workforce. How do we talk about transition? Is there any structural space to talk about or a political space to talk about transition in this process? No, even there are no jobs, unemployment is increasing. So how do we sustain the informal labor workforce? That is very important for us, the challenge for us in this context. How is it possible? What are the new narratives and what are the new norms that we could frame in this process? For example, for a country like India, we have been talking for the last 15 years, a policy for domestic workers. It's not there still. No, that means the existing normative trend is not allowing for a policy for domestic workers. That means employers, all of us sitting here, maybe majority of us sitting here are employees of domestic workers. It starts from president or prime minister or whoever it is. So that means the employer negotiation with comes to the structural negotiation, it becomes impossible in that discussions. So where are we finding, can domestic workers find trust in tripartite discussions? That is the main structural challenge that I would like to expose at this stage. So that is why there is nothing is facilitated in this process. So that is, these are the structural challenges that I'm addressing at this, the normative challenges that I'm addressing at this process. So from this point, from this structural complexities, to representational complexities, to the rise that we are seeing in terms of minimum wages. Now we are talking about a floor wage. Now, who is going to access the floor wage? Means the least, the marginalized, the vulnerable workers of this country is going to access the floor wage. That means they are not going to be entitled or to have the right to entitled the minimum wages, that is, or minimum living wages that we are talking about in the process. So that is again a structural issue that we have to talk about. Social security, that is a big question. COVID has exposed all this, the migrant workers, the domestic workers, home-based workers. None of them had any kind of, the state couldn't offer any kind of support after repeated please from the trade unions or from civil society organizations to support the workers, because there are no mechanisms to enable social security to the workers. That is why I'm saying, what is the role of, if the president of India is an employer of a domestic worker, he or she has the responsibility, or that person has the responsibility, to consider a worker who is working inside their home, as a citizen, as a worker, with equal right in this country. So what is that person's role to the social security? What are the forms that exist to contribute to the social security of that particular classes of workers? That is the only possible way, to rethink or restructure. I don't even say restructure, it is destructuring that should happen in this process. So I think the existing structures, the existing normative discourses that we are propagating. We want to just patch up or squeeze in the rights of the majority of workers into whatever existing form. So I think I'm arguing that it will not allow any of the workers, informal workers in the countries, for any kind of entitlements if we are trying to do that. So what is, and the last one that I would like to say is the trade union, the process of organizing, means what are the limitations of it? As a person representing SEWA in most of the trade union negotiations platforms in the country, I know the limitations of it, because again, this problem is the problem of trade unions also. Trade unions in this country are existing only with the support of the organized workforce. They have existed, they have formed, they have negotiated only for the formal workforce. That means the existing negotiations, collective bargaining process is not at all applicable to the informal workforce. So that is why, why organizing domestic workers or organizing home-based workers is not a priority of any trade unions in the country. It's because it's not that they don't like or they don't want, but the existing structure, negotiation structure, existing history or existing, they are not able to reflect on where we are standing, the crossroads of organizing, where the challenges, how do we understand or how do we again destructure the union process, in order to address majority of the workforce in the country. So I think that is where we have seen many mushrooming of many small unions that is not at all affiliated to any of the major unions, that is happening in different parts of the country, and they are not recognized as unions. And now, for example, in the state rules, means according to the 1926 Trade Union Act and the state rules of that particular act, if we go and register for a trade union of self-employed women, self-employed workers, that will not allow. We will get completely, rejected at each stage because you are not eligible to register as a trade union. So these are fundamental structural issues that, in terms of collective bargaining, I don't accept social dialogue, replacing cultural collective bargaining. That is not. We need new forms, new models, new understandings of collective bargaining without employer, without state, or with state, or without state. Or in that processes, who is representing whom? These are the processes that we have to understand, and how do we develop these processes in terms of including, the most marginalized informal workforce, the women workers, workers who are who are part of the commons, you know, who are based on natural resources, to earn a livelihood, who have been displaced, the migrants who have been displaced as part of the development processes that is happening in this country. So I think I will stop here. I think this debate should bring all these questions so that, these challenges should be taken forward in our future deliberation, future discussion, so that, how could, the academia itself could develop, a framework to address these existing persisting challenges of the majority of the workforce in the country who are out of any of this process, existing structural processes. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sonia George. I'm reminded of this classic Marxian argument. So long the debate is encased within the capitalistic framework, everything, all questions fall to the ground because there are structural imbalances in the system, capitalist system. The same critique, I think, applies to informality. So long the entire, the labor, the trade union movement, the industrial relations system, if all of them are structured and are grounded, leaning on or based on the formal economy, the formal labor institutions, then how do we accommodate the vast majority of informal workers who are either invisible or visible, but not given their identity? Again, it's a question of existential identity, institutional identity. And you have rightly questioned that the existing framework, institutional, trade union, consultative, and various kinds of frameworks do not adequately provide or accommodate the concerns, the pressing concerns of the vast majority of informal workers, be they domestic workers or contract workers or migrant workers. Of course, everybody knows the argument that cheaper labor cost has led to informality, and informality again leads to cheaper labor costs. It's a kind of a vicious circle. But now this debate has raised certain unconventional issues into my knowledge, if I have to give an overarching comment. Professor Jose talked about reinventing labor movement and going to the roots, so to say, and of course, to impart political consciousness to it. And Mr. Sheikh Salahuddin talked about the kind of modern entrapments that the gig workers suffer from at both ends, at the employer's ends and at the consumer delivery ends. On the other hand, Mr. Sultan also interrogated the kind of rechristening that has taken place both within ILO and outside ILO, and the need to re-strategize and keeping the formal economy workers as a kind of affronting them with the shield, and also bringing the vast majority of the army of the informal workers behind them. And Dr. Sonia George completely, again, interrogated the very validity of the consultative framework called tripartism when the state or the employer do not, when for them, there is no employer, no state kind of a context in which they are caught in. And so that it is, there are structural issues in the entire, let me put it as labor ecosystem, for want of a better term, because industrial relations, labor relations, employment relations, all these will not be able to, capture the kind of complexities that Dr. Sonia George threw at us. I mean, in a sense, they are gauntlets for all of us to, to pick up. Now, before I go to this, the way forward and summing up, there are a few questions that have come on the chat box and on the Facebook. So I would like to flag them. Dr. Nagarajan Krishnamurthy has asked, what are all individual rights? What are all community rights? What are all the duties of individual to perform for the betterment of family and community? What are all the community's duties for the betterment of the citizens? This is a question he has asked. Anyone could answer, but there are questions that which could be asked. Dr. Suchita Krishna Prasad has asked Sheikh Salahuddin, do you have any thoughts on women in gig work? And secondly, would there be a difference between the conditions and hence strategies to be deployed for deliverers of goods as against deliverers of services? एक gig economy workers रहता है, वो goods deliver करता है, दूसरा service deliver करता है, like a beautician. ये उनको organize करना है, उनका मुद्दा उठाना है, उसमें कुछ strategy में आपको फर्क पड़ेगा. वही question डॉक्टर सुचिता कृष्णमूर्ति आप सुचिता कृष्ण प्रसाद आपसे पूछ रही है. और दूसरा women in gig economy, you know, उसके बारे में आपका सोच क्या है पूछ रहा है. एंड there are questions, for example, some people have asked, what about occupational safety and health? Will there not be important, you know, as a consideration? That's what Ms. Chitra Khanna has asked. So I request the panelists to kind of pick and answer the questions or the concerns that have been raised by people, by various people. There is a personal question from Anima Sharma to Dr. Sonia Judge. Chitra Khanna's question has come now. In case of accidents at workplace, laws are being violated. However, we do not see effective enforcement. How can it become a non-negotiable agenda of trade union when trade union negotiates with the company? This is a question that Ms. Chitra Khanna has asked everyone. So the questions are before you. So I may ask Professor Jose to start answering each one. Any question you can pick and answer.
Sir, there is one more question. I think it's also for Professor Jose by Pundlik Patel. It just came in Q&A. I will read it out. Sir, in other countries, a lot of labor movements are started, but still now in Indian labor code changes very fastly, but still no any movement are starting or seen. So the country specific question.
So Professor Jose first.
I did not get the last question. Maybe I'll come to it at the end. Shyam, let me say, all of us raised far too many questions because we don't have answers. We are in changing times. We are trying to examine the applicability of widgets, of institutions developed in the past, to improve the situation of people who need institutionalized safeguards, but we are not able to apply them. You drew the distinction between bargaining and social dialogue. Taking cue from the ILO specialist and the crucial question, organizing, which Sonia raised. And you know, this is being, without being offensive, we come across the basic question, organizing for what? And if you say organizing for bargaining, that platform has shrunk over the years on account of the huge array of changes taking place in the workplace, decentralization, dispersion of the workplace, and the decomposition of the workforce itself, meaning it has become divided according to the skill content and the kind of homogeneity which existed in the past, brought them under one roof, made it possible to bargain on their behalf by trade unions. These circumstances do not exist in most cases. So what do we do? And when we talk about rights, all those extremely interesting questions about whose rights are we talking about? What rights? What about individual rights? What about collective rights? What about responsibilities? All those questions, the fact of the matter is, right through history, there's one important lesson. Whoever exercised rights, these rights were not given to them. They had taken it. They had taken it, demanded it. And that was a lengthy process of consolidating their economic space based on which they strengthened their political space. That's what enabled them to demand the rights. And as societies matured, they took those rights, got them constitutionalized. It is this process we have got to make sure continues in our time. But then the odds are heavy, as again pointed out by Sonia more than anyone else, that we are confronting a situation where we don't have people who are accountable, who are answerable, who would be prepared to respond. The employers are not there, the state is not interested, and we have this burgeoning workforce at the lower end of the pyramid, denied the kind of protection and safeguard which they require more than anyone else. And what do we do? And that's where I believe it has got to be part of a political process of strengthening their economic space, and to which the only solution I can think of is build a political campaign to increase the quantum of social spending. Social spending on education, on healthcare, on housing, on better quality living. That is what would eventually enhance their ability to bargain. And I might be saying counterintuitive things when she pointed out the declining, diminishing participation rate, especially of women. To me, the answer lies in making work more attractive to them, meaning pay them better wages, create better social security safeguards for them. That will make it possible to move out of the pressings of the household. Right now, we report a low labor force participation rate, but make them part of the paid labor force. And that means raise their reserve price. Make it possible for them to come out of the pressings of the house and go for a better paid job. That means the entire society has got to work towards that goal. And that goal can be attained only when we raise the quantum of social spending. And that again is not a matter of limited resources. I still believe, and I sincerely believe, that the society we belong to has abundant resources for initiating such significant social spending that in turn will raise their reserve price, bring them out into the labor force. I know I'm saying something which is immediately counterintuitive, but then I sincerely believe that raising the offer price is what would unleash the kind of explosion of participation in the world of work. But then let me not spend more time because we have exceeded the time, but it was worth listening to you. Thank you. And I greatly appreciate having had this opportunity to talk to you, all of you like this. And I look forward to having more such opportunities in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jos, for that. May I request Sheikh Salahuddin to respond?
थैंक यू या जैसे कि अर्बन आज के तारीख में अगर जब वुमेन्स को लेके देखेंगे तो गिग वर्कर गिग इकोनॉमी में भी अगर जब टेस्ट साइड में देखे तो पहले बहुत कम था। बीते हुए 3 साल से अगर जब हम बात करें तो मुंबई दिल्ली जैसे सिटीज में बहुत सारे महिला गिग वर्कर्स में आना स्टार्ट करे, ओला में ऊबर में काम करना स्टार्ट करे, एट द सेम टाइम स्विगी जोमैटो में भी काम देखने के लिए मिल रहा उनके लिए। बट एक है देखिए, अभी अर्बन कंपनी भी आप रिसेंटली देखेंगे गुड़गांव के अंदर बहुत बड़ा प्रोटेस्ट चला था महिलाओं को लेके, 100 वुमेन जो थे रात दिन वहां पे प्रोटेस्ट कर रहे थे, जो अर्बन कंपनी का बिहेवियर था उस वर्कर्स को लेके रात दिन रहते, पर भी वहां पे लाइट्स बंद किया गया, वॉशरूम्स को तक नहीं जाने दिया फीमेल वर्कर्स को, ठीक है ना, मेल नहीं, फीमेल वर्कर्स के ऊपर भी, जो आजकल के गिग इकोनॉमी पे जो काम कर रहे उन लोग सारे जो कंपनीज के है वो बिहेवियर देखे होंगे। तो हमारा यही है कि हम लोग एज ए यूनियंस फेडरेशन हम लोग यही हर स्टेट में यही कर रहे कि अवेयरनेस क्रिएट करना, जैसा अभी सर ने कहा कि हम लोग अवेयरनेस क्रिएट करने में है और उनको रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशन संभालने में है, कानून क्या बोल रहा, क्योंकि अभी कानून बना नहीं, तो जब कानून बनेगा तो ये सारे चीज कहाँ पे लेके आके हम मर्ज करना होगा और कहाँ पे हमारी फाइट करना होगा, किस सेक्टर में करना होगा, किस जोन में करना होगा, किसके खिलाफ करना होगा। अब तो कंपनी के खिलाफ कर रहे बट गवर्नमेंट के अंदर कैटेगरी वाइज हम कहाँ पे करना होगा, चाहे लेबर ट्रांसपोर्ट या आईटी, ये कैडर हमें को मिल सकता है आगे अगले आने वाले दिनों में। हमें बस यही वेट करना है कि जब तक वहां से ड्राफ्ट रूल बन के नहीं आएगा, कानून जब नहीं बनेगा गिग वर्कर्स प्लेटफॉर्म वर्कर्स पे, जब तक तो एक कंपनीज को खुली छूट दे के रखी सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट ने, तो अर्बन कंपनीज पे नहीं, दूसरे जितने भी गिग वर्कर्स के ओपनिंग्स है कंपनीज के अंदर, चाहे जो भी डिलीवरी सेक्टर हो ड्राइवर सेक्टर हो, वहां पे थोड़ा थोड़ा वुमेन्स के लिए भी आना स्टार्ट हो गया। इतना ही नहीं, हम लोग हमारे यूनियन के अंदर भी, इंडियन फेडरेशन ऑफ एप बेस्ड ट्रांसपोर्ट वर्कर्स के फेडरेशन में भी, हम लोग ने महिला को एक लीडर क्वालिटी बनाना, उनके पैरों पे उनको खड़े करना और उनकी अम्ब्रेला उनको फॉलो अप करने के लिए भी अपॉर्चुनिटीज दे रहे, तो ऐसी हम लोग ने महिला की भी विंग, वुमेन विंग की बना रहे हम लोग। वुमेन विंग का ऑलरेडी हमारे पास पैनल है, वो चाहे टैक्सीज के ड्राइवर्स को, वुमेन ड्राइवर्स ओला उबर को लेके, चाहे डिलीवरी सेक्टर्स के ड्राइवर्स को लेके मिलना, बातचीत करना, उनके इश्यूज को हाईलाइट करना, जो कंपनीज के ऊपर वुमेन्स का एक अलग रोल है, जैसे कि उनके मेटरनरी बेनिफिट्स क्या है, उनके सोशल सिक्योरिटीज के अंदर क्या क्या कंपनीज ने अवॉइड कर रखा, उनके लिए क्या आज के तारीख में एसेंशियल जरूरत है, और कैटेगरीज वाइज में भी वो होना जरूरी है, मेल फीमेल के अंदर यहाँ पे बहुत सारे हेल्थ को लेके और सेफ्टी को लेके बहुत सारे टर्म्स एंड कंडीशंस डिफरेंट है, क्योंकि अगर जहाँ एक वुमेन ड्राइवर रात के दिन काम कर रही तो उसका सेफ्टी एंड सिक्योरिटी क्या है, तो एज इट इज वेर इट इज ये भी देखना है, कंपनी का रोल क्या है, गवर्नमेंट का रोल क्या है, एट द सेम टाइम उसकी सेफ्टी क्या है और हेल्थ सेफ्टी क्या है, जैसे अभी हम लोग बताए वेटरनरी के बाद में, और उनका जब टाइम होगा उसके ऊपर क्या है, उनका लॉस ऑफ पे देंगे या नहीं, ठीक है, ये सारे चीज अभी भी अधूरे है। तो इन लोग के लिए मेरा यही है कि उन लोग भी बढ़ चढ़ के हिस्सा लेके इसके अंदर काम करना चाहिए, ऐसा नहीं है कि उनको कहीं साइड में रखना चाहिए, बट हमारे साथ साथ हमको उनको भी खांदा मिला के हम लोग पूरा सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं और उनके साथ भी रहेंगे हम। थैंक यू।
डॉक्टर सोनिया जॉर्ज, वुड यू लाइक टू रेस्पॉन्ड टू सम ऑफ देम? Any of them?
No, I would. I'm interested in responding to this question of no, why there is not such a movement in this country, labor movement, as no, the labor codes are no fastly getting implemented. I think that's a question that we ourselves are asking and the workers' movement in the country has to critically ask ourselves, means why it's so it's not happening. Especially in the context of the farmers movement, the kind of success that they have achieved after an year long struggle, the labor movement means always the labor movement was in close working in close solidarity with the farmers movement, but why the labor movement is not able to work on par with the farmers in terms of addressing the issues of workers or the labor codes, means I feel that the labor codes, it got accepted very fast. There was no such resistance, no strong resistance from even the workers unions themselves, at different stages they got implemented it very fast, and now means, and you know in the parliament how they have been passed even without discussion. So I think it again goes back to the questions that I have raised, means the labor force is not, the labor union is not able to bring its workforce, the informal workforce, into, you know, the struggle path, because, you know, we haven't been able to raise the issues of these workers. We haven't been able to form, you know, models to organize these workers at large scale. You know, the informal workers in this country, I think, even the labor movement can, couldn't organize even 10% of, more than 93% of the informal workers in the country. I think that is a big question, you know, big reality to reflect on, you know, to look back, and what should we do and how could we negotiate? Now the country is going to have a 2-day strike. You know, what is it we ourselves will ask, you know, states like Kerala or some other parts, like maybe previously it used to be Bengal, or some other states, no, it will become standstill. All other states, everything will be normal. So what will be the impact of such big strikes rather than, no? We have to reach to the workers. We have to reach to, no, people, no, the mass who are the real workforce, no? Whenever, no, we used to go for strikes, no, the formal sector workers, no, in terms of starting from the strike notice itself, the unions will ensure that they will not lose their wages or any other rights at any point. But when it comes to informal workers, the existing system is not able to support or ensure the workers that, you know, if they don't go to work, means they don't have any money. They don't have any kind of support system that is working. So the informal workers have to go to work, means nobody is there to support those workers. So that is a reality. And how do we address that reality? So that is very important for us in terms of social, as Josar has repeatedly pointed out, no, the responsibility on social spending, no, how could it apply to the mass, no, the poor, the vulnerable workers in the country, no? How could this bridge be built up between, no, these categories of people, no, who are able to support or who are able to contribute to social spending? That is very important for us. And we have to discuss that, no, at a large scale. No, we have been asking for domestic workers. Is it possible to keep 1% of the house tax collected in the country for social security? As social security for the domestic workers. The government don't even want to think about those kind of possibilities that could be possible. No, we had a special flat cess, or we had GSTs at different levels. No, what contribution of that goes to, no, these workers who are the backbone of the economy of this country. You know, they are contributing to more than 50% of the economy. You know, it's not that they are keeping away, but I think when you calculate, when you measure it, you know, with a new form of calculation or measurement, you know, considering, you know, even the demographic transition, I'm sure that around 70% of the contribution comes at different levels, because home-based work, it's not calculated at any levels of no economy. Domestic work, it's not calculated. No, such kind of, no, when, no, the so-called menial works that we are calling unrecognized works, no, those are not at all calculated in sustaining the economy, no, in sustaining the productivity, no, in sustaining the service of this country. So I think we have to take all this, no, in order to, no, the economists should sit together and calculate or find out new measurement systems, no, how this is becoming possible. The labor specialists should come together, or the labor economists, no, how could this convergence be possible? So that is what I have to say. And in terms of safety, that is something that have come up at many points in the discussions, no. The occupational safety that, you know, the mainstream movements and the mainstream structure is raising, that is completely away from, you know, the real occupational hazards that the workers are facing. For example, increasing violence. No, none of the occupational safety measures, no, have any system to tackle violence, sexual violence, or violence in workplace. Nothing is there. So without considering that, how could we talk about occupational safety in workplace or of workers? So these are very fundamental questions, you know, that we have to ask in terms of addressing the rights of, you know, the informal workers. I think that is what we have to go forward. And once again, thank you so much, you know, for making me part of this discussions and also part of this kind of discussions that is happening quite frequently. Thank you so much. And thanks to be part of a wonderful panel.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Sonia Judge. Mr. Sultan, would you like to share any thoughts based on the proceeding?
Thank you. I think everything covered. You know, I don't want to prolong the discussion. It's very, very easy discussion. Only I can say that, there are three areas we discussed about the supply chain and whom to organize, why to organize. I think at the end, we need to make political mobilization and political strategy to make national government accountable. Because whatever the TT, whatever the global policies and everything, that ultimately is depend on the national government, how they endorse this thing, how they introduce this thing in the respective countries. So, and also side by side, we need the global agencies, especially UN agencies and others, those who are dealing with the things, to how to make actually all the global actors to bring them together to make the universal a strategy to accountable the global business and corporate house. So this is two things we need to design our work in future how to do it. As I may not write completely, but I feel that at the end actually it's national government who decide the things and we need to deal with them through political mobilization. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sultan. I'm sure, friends, that we have had very insightful and quite interrogative and even provocative the discussions, thoughts that have been shared by the panelists. And if, as Professor Jose says, that we have asked far too many questions than discussing answers, the fault lines are there for us to see. For Professor Jose, it is fiscal progressive thinking that's required on the one hand and political mobilization on the other hand. For Mr. Sheikh Salahuddin, they are struggling for their fundamental existential recognition, and they are knocking at whatever doors that they could look at, including the judiciary. For Mr. Sultan, there is a serious need to re-strategize both at the political level and at the national level. And for Dr. Sonia Judge, the whole thing is smacks of mainstream thinking and mainstream structures. Where is the space for the vast majority of informal workers? We do not have any institutional, social, political, legal, and any other processes to provide them even a sense of visibility. I just want to end with one thought. ILO has been sticking to this tripartism, and I believe that a kind of small accommodation has been made by coining a phrase called tripartite plus. Will the tripartite plus satisfy institutional players like Seva and Dr. Sonia Judge? I do not know. So in other words, this panel discussion, which has been hosted by IMPRI, Indian Social Institute, and I know that Father Denzel George is there, listening, and also counterview. The whole thing is that this panel discussion has asked very, very fundamental questions, because the topic is so fundamental and so affected that we ought to ask questions. And I'm sure they will, the answers are there. Answers would be there on the field. And we hope we rejoin sometime later with more, with fewer answers, at least few answers, if not many answers. With these final concluding remarks, I hand over the process to Dr. Arjun Kumar. But prior to that, I wish to thank each and every panelist for making such engaging conversations on this wonderful, but to me, it's a perennial theme. It's not a one-off theme. Thanks a lot. And over to Dr. Arjun Kumar and his associates. Thank you very much. I stand enriched.
Thank you so much, Professor K.R. Shyamsundar. I totally echo your thoughts that we all stand enriched by this very, very passionate deliberation that went on the labor movements in India at 75. So thank you so much. I would like to propose the formal vote of thanks on behalf of the IMPRI Center for Work and Welfare, Indian Social Institute, New Delhi, and Counterview. Thank you to all our participants today for joining us. I would like to take the opportunity to thank all our panelists, Professor A.V. Jose, Mr. Sheikh Salahuddin, Dr. Sonia George, Mr. Sultanuddin, Mr. Sayyid Sultanuddin Ahmed. Also, Mr. Ashim Roy, he couldn't join us, though he sends his greetings. Thank you so much to all of you. And most of all, the moderator for this session, Professor K.R. Shyamsundar, thank you so much. It has been a wonderful listening to all of you. And thank you for very succinctly summing up the session. So thank you so much. We are indeed very grateful. And most of all, thank you so much to Father Dr. Denzel Fernandez for being here and listening to the program and session so keenly. I would also like to thank all our attendees who joined in here on Zoom, and they also posed very interesting questions and comments, and also to those who are watching us on Facebook Live. And I would like to thank everybody in advance who will be watching us later on YouTube and listening to the program on our various podcasts. So thank you so much, and I wish you all a very good day, good evening, and take care of yourself. Stay safe. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.